Okay, picture the scene. You're a railway engineer in the very early years of railway construction. Now come and take a look at this. So this is one of hundreds of embankments on this single railway. And this is like an access tunnel underneath it. One of many pieces of infrastructure, including a tunnel a few hundred yards that way. We'll come to that shortly. The money is there, as is your reputation, but you have a problem. Your means of moving a train along a railway is a steam locomotive, and this is causing you a great many headaches. The loco itself is extremely heavy, plus a heck of a lot of water and coal on board too. While the rails are often breaking, the boilers on these locos would sometimes explode. The adhesion of iron on iron wheels is also causing numerous problems. The whole system was completely inefficient. A solution was needed. Now, in these early era railway building, well, the blueprint was yours to design. So what are you gonna do? Now, if your answer is to build an atmospheric type pressured railway with pumping stations every 5 miles, well, you'd probably be right, but it's not quite as simple as that, because that failed monumentally. And the story of how we got to that point is a fascinating one. Again, riddled with issues, not the ones you might think. Now, I'm also going to be walking one of my favourite abandoned railways today, the Midlands and Southwestern Junction Railway. I'm just north of Chedworth. So I'll tell you this story as I show you a few quirky bits and pieces along the line. Tunnel first. Today, the solution is clear. The most efficient way we move trains along a railway is by having a static electric power source. In other words, we remove the engine from the train and place it along the side of the railway. We have a third rail in the southeast of England and electric overhead wires on a lot of the major routes throughout the country. Lo and behold, our engineers back then had the same idea. If they could remove the power source from the engine, well, problems solved. The adhesion, the weight, and if they had that, well, that came with a greater efficiency, and that would mean more cash for your shareholders. Now, if you're thinking that means I'm going to jump straight to his Lord Chief and Commander, Isambard Kingdom Brunel, well, you'd be wrong, because the story starts long before that, and it's far more interesting. The year is 1799, and a man named George Medhusrt is tinkering with atmospheric pressure. Now, by trade, he is a mechanical engineer, but he also invents stuff. Medhusrt was constantly tinkering with a specific fascination on pneumatics. Come 1810 and 1812, he produced some short books. They contained ideas on moving letters and goods and people by rails using atmospheric pressure. Now, before we get to the tunnel, we're on a huge embankment. It's really undulating here. I can't quite begin to describe how steep that is down there. Now, Medhusrt, well, he was well ahead of its time, it seemed. I'm really surprised I haven't heard of him before. He was insistent that this system, which was encased in a tube with the right physics, a steam engine at the mouth of the tunnel, he insisted this could go 100 miles an hour and it could be used all over the country. For Medhusrt, well, the world wasn't ready for this technology. Instead, he went on to successfully invent the leak-proof canal lock and the steam carriage, to name some of many. 1824, in steps a man called Valance. And he's got a similar tube type system. This time it's 6 foot in diameter and it's got cast iron rails for the train to travel along. Now, that seems a little bit crazy. You've not heard of the braking system. Well, to slow the thing down, you needed to open the doors. That's crazy by any Victorian standards. Suffice to say, it didn't catch on. Next up, we've got a tunnel just behind the camera. Let's go take a look. 1827, and we're back with George Medhusrt. He's got a new idea, a new book, a new pamphlet, and it's entitled...
A New System of Inland Conveyance for Goods and Passengers Capable of Being Applied and Extended Throughout the Country and of Conveying All Kinds of Goods, Cattle and Passengers with a velocity of 6 miles in an hour at an expense that will not exceed the 1/4 part of the present mode of travelling without the aid of horses or any animal power.
Now, this system was similar to his previous one, but this time he'd upped his game. He'd worked out all sorts of new things that would be essential, even a signalling system. He worked out new pressures, new measurements, new speeds. But the one difference between this system, the one difference that would make everybody's interest peak a little bit more, was the fact that this time he talked about passengers on the outside of the tube. Journeys between London and Edinburgh were now discussed. Now, speaking of tubes, I did promise you a look at a tunnel, and I'm instead now looking at the very beautiful Chedworth Tunnel. I think it's like 500-ish yards long, and see if we can have a look inside. And I've got the best torch with me, so unfortunately can't get an amazing view, but nevertheless, to appreciate the work that went into that. Now, Medhusrt died in 1827, and unfortunately his work died with him. But it didn't go unnoticed. Now, it would be harsh not to mention Henry Pincus here. He built a slot type system alongside the 2 mile Kensington Canal in 1835. It was successful, but he failed to attract investors. I love a good tunnel. Now, we've got something else coming up in a little bit to show you, which is perhaps for me more exciting than the tunnel. You'll have to hold on to see that. Now, 1835, Joseph and Jacob Samudas, well, they'd read the work of Medhusrt. They were by trade shipbuilders. It was seemingly an age when you could just have a random sideline, like building a tube for an atmospheric railway. And they came up with something which probably closely resembled what we would now know as the atmospheric railway, that system of the tube on the ground, nearly buried in the ground, with a train pulled along by it. A continuous tube with a slot in the top, which would have a piston in attached to the above train, in which in turn is on rails above the tube. Simple. Now, with the Samudas system, a pumping station ahead of the train would pump air out of the tube, creating a vacuum, or at least an air pressure differential, and subsequently it would pull the train along. 1840, and the Samudas ran a test for quite some months, and they attracted a lot of good things. They attracted people that wanted to invest in this new system, but they also attracted a couple of bad things. Rivals, and a lot of them, all with variations. 1841, and this really was a technology that people saw the greatest potential in. We now have a significant number of steam-hauled railways propping up everywhere. If someone could just get this idea right, this would be the future. The Samudas wrote a treatise, and within a few years they'd actually written a patent for their system. Now, this included the use of tallow as a means to reduce friction. Word had spread far and wide about this system. In fact, the Dublin and Kingston Railway in Southern Ireland, at the time using horsepower to pull passengers, had heard about this new atmospheric system of Samudas and Clegg and insisted that this was indeed the future. They desired an extension of their line and installed this system with success in 1844. So down below is Chedworth. Now, Chedworth did have a station, but there's nothing to see today. What I'm going to do is take you further on to that. The next station on the line, we're in for quite a treat. This point in time now, this was a turning point, this railway. It would use the technology of sucking the train up the hill by its atmospheric pressure, and it would just gravitate back downhill again. And the likes of Stevenson and Brunel all went to go and see this. Of course, the question on their mind was, would this work on a much grander scale? We're soon to find out. So we now have these systems popping up all over the place, the London and Croydon, the Paris Saint-Germain. Let's pop to 1844 and go and see our friend Brunel. The GWR has reached Exeter from Paddington, and there's a big desire now to cross down the coast and over the hills on towards Plymouth. Isambard Kingdom Brunel had visited the Dalkey Railway. He had seen it. He had seen the success and wanted a piece of this action. He realised that the greatest issue in reaching Plymouth was the potential gradient. The atmospheric railway would truly come to life here. In fact, the route, it seems, was planned for such technologies. A few weeks on from the authorisation, since the passing of the Act, a proposal had been received from Messiahs, the Samuda brothers, to apply their system of traction to the South Devon line. Game on. At last, we're getting a proper railway. 1848, and all trains that run between Exeter and Newton Abbot, the flat bit, well, they are run by the atmospheric railway technology. Cracking stuff. Now, I've been wanting to show you this all day long. I've finally walked here from the other side of Chedworth. This is Foss Cross, and in terms of abandoned railway stuff, tangible stuff that you can see, it doesn't get better than this. Have a look at this. There were a couple of early teething problems. An electric telegraph to the pumping stations was yet to be installed, and coal consumption was extremely high. Plus, there were some significant miscalculations with the pipe diameter for steeper sections. Foss Cross building still survives today. I absolutely love this. I hope it never changes. It's slightly off the beaten track. It's in the middle of nowhere. I think this was built as the first incarnation of Chedworth Station. It's like 2 miles from Chedworth. The locals of Chedworth said, we want our own station, so they built that. And this pretty much became redundant from a passenger point of view, to a lesser degree. So much for agricultural goods, that sort of thing. And there was a man here that would stay overnight because, or the station master still remained because there was a passing train at the loop that was here at 11 o'clock in the evening. But wow, the building still remains today. You've got the toilets down the end. I hope it doesn't ever change. I hope the person that owns this bit of land does nothing to this. Okay, just walking down the platform now of Foss Cross. What a gorgeous setting. Now, these problems, well, they were easy to overcome. And once you had overcome those problems, well, that was it, long-term issue fixed. But these were indeed the least of the problems they're about to face. ...1848, and the hard frost of the winter would dry out the leather and it would cause it to almost stay open. And you can imagine this caused a loss of pressure from the entire system. It just didn't work. They overcame this, but the summer brought about the same problems. The dry conditions of the heat, well, it dried the leather out, shrunk it upwards, and again you lose air pressure. The system started to fail. Brunel needed a solution, and that was whale oil. He thought this would fix the problem of drying out and frost. It was suggested at the time that the Dalkey railway leather flap had an iron casing on its top. This helped strengthen it and stabilise it. This was left out on the South Devon railway design, possibly because of the higher speeds. Samuda was contracted to maintain the line, and part of that contractual obligation, he made a lot of recommendations to Brunel how to keep this in good condition. Brunel really didn't take up many of those recommendations, including looking after that leather flap that sat on top. Well, the line needed replacing at a cost of £32,000. Samuda gladly declined and pointed out Brunel's failings. 29th of August 1848, and Brunel advised abandonment of the atmospheric railway. Now, you might be typing below already that rats ate the leather too. Well, it turns out this could be a myth. There is no record of anywhere that I can find of this being the case. Perhaps rats were actually a thing. I guess we'll never really know. But in any event, the erosion of the leather on top and the sill, that was always going to be the problem. And it certainly proved to be the downfall. The story is a lot deeper than that. And there's a lot more different technologies that were worked upon in those early days. And I'll put a lot of the links so you can explore further as I say goodbye to the very beautiful Foss Cross. I've had an assistant behind the camera today. This is Sam. Sam's got her own channel. Sam walks a lot.
Yes.
So go and subscribe to Sam's channel. Link in the description below. Thanks for your help, Sam.
You're welcome. It's been fun.
It has been fun, hasn't it?
It has.